I may be wrong, but I'm perfectly willing to swear that when you turned and smiled at me, a nightingale sang in Berkeley Square. The moon that lingered over London town, poor puzzle moon, he wore a frown. How could he know we two were so in love? The whole darn world seemed upside down. The streets of town were paved with stars. It was such a romantic affair. And as we kissed and said goodnight, the nightingale sang in Berkeley Square. Dawn came stealing up, all gold and blue, to interrupt our rendezvous. I still remember how you smiled and said, was that a dream, or was it true? Our homeward step was just as light as the dancing of Fred Astaire, and like an echo far away. A nightingale sang in Berkeley Square.
Lost his way. He broke his wing. I helped him heal, and then he flew away. Well, the death of love is everywhere, but I won't let it be. There will be no love that's dying here for me. There will be no love that's dying here. The mirror that fell from the wall was raggedy, that's all. It rests upon a rusty nail before it made us fall. Well, the bones of love are everywhere, but I won't let it be. There will be no love that's dying here for me. There will be no love that's dying here. For flowers in my Asian vase is not a sign we're dead. I paid for three, a sweet old lady gave me four instead. There's some doubt that's out about this love, but I won't let it be. There will be no love that's dying here for me. There will be no love that's dying here. The bird that flew in through my window simply lost his way. He broke his wings, I helped him heal, and then he flew away. Well, the death of love is everywhere, but I won't let it be. There will be no love that's dying here for me. No, there will be no love that's dying for me. There will be no love that's dying for you and me. Oh, there will be no love dying here. No, not for me. There will be no love that's dying here. No, there will be no love that's dying here. No, 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 no.
You say your family plays in your faith journey?
They were it.
Uh-huh.
They were the purpose of my being. And they call me the queen. Why, I don't know. My family's members think I have all of the answers. And I don't. Mine comes from maybe experience, I don't know. But I give them what I believe is wise information. And they can take it, or they can leave it. They don't have to use it, but then they shouldn't ask for an opinion. I'm thinking of a time when I knew that there was something more than just me. I was in the hospital, waiting for them to take me up for breast surgery. And just laying there, all of a sudden, I saw the most beautiful blue sky. And I just knew that this was God. I knew that He was watching me and that I was going to be taken care of. I had no fear of not making it in surgery, because I knew that God was on my side. The question has been asked, how can I inspire other women? I don't really know if I could. I think each person has a direction that they must follow. It isn't something that an individual can do because you have done it. This has to be something that you as an individual wants to do. I enjoy giving to persons who have a need. If I can help financially, on a limited basis, of course, I will do that. And it makes me feel good that I have been able to help someone. It makes me feel sad when I see programs on television where women are being ostracized or being hurt physically. And words can mean so, so much. All you have to do sometimes is just smile or say, how are you today? Or tell them that they look good, even if they don't. Pick something out that you notice that they have gone to the trouble of preparing. I like to look at the ladies coming in for church. And I look at those shoes that they wear. They look so good on their feet. I know what they would look like on mine. But I let them know, I said, oh, I like your shoes. Well, that's a pretty dress. And it makes them feel that all of the effort that they have put themselves to in order to get to church, to look the best they can, makes me feel good that I'm able to give them a little bit of encouragement by saying, ah, you look good today.
Amen. We thank God for the life and for the legacy of our dear Miss Fannie Cockfield. That footage you saw was from a Women's Day celebration here at South Euclid, where our theme was queenin'. And we wanted to hear words of wisdom from one of the queens from within our congregation. We thank God for those words of wisdom. If you would, continue to keep this family lifted in prayer as we will begin our celebration of life and legacy of Miss Fannie Cockfield momentarily. And we are thankful for the support of E.F. Boyd & Son Funeral Home as we bid our final farewell. I'm laughing because I said this woman must have been an AKA. Because she buried in a bad green casket. I ain't even mad at you, King. From the other team, salutes to you, girl. Salutes to you. Amen. I said, I must have missed that. Amen. We thank God. Can we just for a moment, can we put our hands together and celebrate the life and the legacy? Amen. Of Miss Fannie Cockfield. We thank God for her. We thank God for her life, for her legacy, and for her longevity. Amen. I want to begin with our call to worship. The psalmist declares these words, I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear thereof and be glad. This is your role. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt God's name together. Friends, we have come here into the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, release our anger, face our emptiness,
and know that God covers and God cares. We gather here as God's people, conscious of others who have gone before and of the frailty of our own existence. We come to comfort and to support one another in the common loss of our sister and friend. We gather here to hear God's word of hope that can drive away our despair and move us to offer God our praise. We gather to commend to God with thanksgiving the life of Miss Fannie Cockfield as we celebrate the good news of the resurrection in Christ. For whether we live or whether we die, here's what Fannie knew. We belong to Christ, who is Lord of both the living yes. and of the dead. Would you pray with me? Awesome, mighty, gracious, loving, and always faithful God, whose ways are not our ways, and whose thoughts are not our own. Grant that your Holy Spirit may intercede for us with signs too deep for human words. Heal our wounded hearts made heavy by sorrow. And through the veil of our tears and the silence of our emptiness, assure us again that no eye has seen and no ear has heard what you have in store for those who love you. Amen, amen, and amen. May the Lord add a blessing to our worship experience together. Now let us receive this musical selection, and then I will return to read our Old and New Testament scriptures. God, for that musical tribute and selection. And at this time, I want to lift up scriptures identified by the family that were meaningful to the life of Miss Fannie Cockfield, who took her faith seriously. A classic selection here found for the Old Testament reading in Psalm 23, These words are found there. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, here's what Fannie knew, I will fear no evil. Why? Because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Here's the good news. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then from Romans chapter 12, I'd like to read verses 1 and 2 and then jump down to verse 9 and read through to 21. These words from Romans 12, select verses are found this way. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. And building right off of Fannie's words found in our video today, we jump down to verse 9, which declares, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. And if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. And in doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, teaching, and preaching of God's most holy and gracious word. Amen. Amen. By your presence here today, it is evident that Miss Fannie Cockfield meant something special to you. And I've pastored long enough to know that when folks make time to come to a service like this, it's because you understand the blessing that God sent into your life through someone like Miss Fannie Cockfield. And so I know that all of us, myself included, have a Fannie Cockfield story to tell. Something she said, something she did, a moment where her words made the difference. But I also have pastored long enough to know that days like today can be taxing on a family. Everyone's doing their best to show up first for Fannie, second for everyone else, and also for themselves. And so we have identified three individuals who will come forward that the family has chosen to offer words of comfort and reflection. But you may be here today with your own story, with your own words of meaning, with your own tale of how Fannie did something to help ease life and make it better for you, to enrich your time here on earth. And I want to tell you that the holiday season is coming. Pick up the phone on those days and share your story. Birthdays are coming. Pick up the phone and share your stories on those days. There will be monumental moments in the life of this family, moments where Mama's smile would have made all the difference. That's your time to step in and let God use you. So we ask if, out of respect for this family, we would invite Rhonda, Zara, and Erica, as names are printed in the program, to come forward at this time. You may share your words of reflection. We ask that you do your best to keep it to 2 minutes. We'll give you a little bit of grace. But if I stand, it means the Lord is near. And if I come close, it means what thou intendest to do, do quickly. But I'm sure we won't find ourselves in those predicaments. Let us continue to worship in spirit and in truth. Amen.
My mother, Cloggy Crowder, was a dear friend of Fannie. And she was asked to speak. And she said, "Rhonda, I just can't do it. Can you do it for me?" And I cannot tell my mother no. So I asked my mother, how did, because Fannie just appeared in our lives. and so I had to ask my mother, and I knew she was a member of the church, but I said, "Well, how did you and Fannie become friends?" And she said, "Well, we became friends when she first joined the church. And one day," and they had a mutual friend, many may remember Mary Gwen. "And one day my mother, who was catching the church van at the time, was standing outside waiting to be brought home. And Mary Gwen told Fannie that my mother lived around the corner from her. And Fannie said, 'Oh, well, I'll take you home.'" And initially, Fannie would, after church, go to the nursing home to spend time with her late husband. Well, after her husband passed away, I think she didn't want to go home and be alone. And so she asked my mother to go out to lunch with her. And that began this very long ritual. Every Sunday, Fannie came to pick up my mother. They went to church. After church, they went out to lunch, and my mother would go to work afterwards. Fannie would drop her off at work. And I got to know Fannie because Fannie would pull in our driveway every Sunday morning, but she never blew the horn. She just pulled in the driveway, and she sat there. My mother would say, "Go tell Fannie I'm on my way." And when I would go out there to let her know, she always smiled, and we may have a little conversation. Fannie exemplified a beautiful person. She was just so beautiful inside and out. She was a blessing. She was blessed, and she was a blessing to others. She shared so many words of wisdom, and the thing I probably remember most, because I was a reporter for the Call and Post newspaper, and Fannie was a longtime subscriber. And she always said that her husband told her that she had to support that paper. And when her subscription didn't come, she would ask me to look into it. And I would go to the office and say, "Fannie Cockfield needs her paper." She was very supportive. She was very supportive of, she loved the church. She was very supportive of the church. She was very supportive of United Black Christians. And when I wrote my book, she bought a copy. I don't think she ever read it. But she always would send word with my mother to say, when is she going to write the next book? And I owe that to Fannie. So the last thing that I want to say is she loved her family so much. She loved her children. And Ross and Susan, you all took such great care of Fannie. And I think that that is just really an example of how well she took care of you all and how well she took care of others. And Fannie will truly be loved and missed. Thank you.
This is a little tough. Just looking at you guys' faces and hearing your words of love. Normally, I'm a woman of a lot of words. Y'all know me. But in this space, I'm humbled. I'm grateful. I'm extremely appreciative. A grandmother's love is and will forever be one of the most amazing feelings, acts, presence, stability, faithfulness, loyalty, just a giant. Just a giant to us. My entire family. She asks, why is she the queen? As I look around the room, you know, she is that example of queenship. Her softness, her unspoken words, they were just so loud. It was her grace, her soft touch, her laughter, the simpleness, and just being what she was and who she is. We are an example of that love. I'm forever grateful for my grandmother. I just wrote a little bit while we were riding in the limousine. And I'll just read it just briefly. Our grandmother, the pop and snap and crackle, the B and bomb, the Z and Zaza, the matter-of-factish and the word extraordinary, the sassy, classy. She was that one. She was it, the standard. And she will always and forever be our queen. Grandma, may you rest. Continue to rest. She's so spoiled. So spoiled. And may we see you again in love and in whatever lives. You always and will forever be in our hearts. And we miss you. And we continue to miss you deeply. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. I wrote my words. Try to keep it under 2 minutes. So Fannie Cockfield had many names, but my siblings, cousins, and I called her Grandma. And as you saw, there was a video of Grandma that was shared with the family where she stated, "My family was it. They were the purpose of my being." She then went on to say, "They called me Queen. Why? I don't know. Well, today, I hope to shed some light on the reason. When I was a young girl, Grandma often seemed somewhat magical, like in the fairy tales. She was stovetop Jiffy Pop, hot cocoa with marshmallows. She was a glass dish of M&Ms, a subtle Hershey's kiss. She was musical and would sing, 'Mama's little baby loves shortening bread.' I don't know to this day what shortening bread is, but she was that too. She had a knight in shining armor who adorned her with the castle poetry letters and gifts. The home she created somehow morphed to encompass all of us at once, and we would be intertwined like her ribbon candy. She was as whimsical as the numerous ballets and plays each one of us accompanied her to. She could even fly. I witnessed her in one leap clear, not one, but two hedges, when my older brother hit her with a snowball. She was a vegetable garden, fruit trees and grapevines. Everything she touched thrived, including us, which is how, along with the grace of God, she would be present to witness our transition into adulthood, graduations, few weddings, and special occasions, and why we would present to her our children to be yet another product of her blessings and prayers. In the same video aforementioned, she spoke about knowing there was something more than just her. And the scripture came to mind, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, NIV. "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Her life as we knew it would be exemplary. She always appeared unwavered, unscathed. Grandma, once herald majestic, heroic, now angelic, and returned to the throne of God. This is the reason we call her Queen.
There's no pain Jesus can't feel, no hurt that he cannot heal. All things work according to his perfect will. No matter what you're going through, remember God is going to use you. For this battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. There Jesus can't feel. No sorrow he cannot heal. All these work according to his perfect will. No matter what you're going through, remember God is gonna use you. For this battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. It's the Lord's. Yes, it's the Lord's. Hold your head up high, don't you cry. It's the Lord's. It's the Lord's. Yes, it's the Lord's. No matter what you're going through, remember God is gonna use. For this battle is not yours, it's the Lord's. It's the Lord's. Yes, it's the Lord's. Hold your head up high, don't cry. It's the Lord's.
Our first resolution is coming from the International Association of Black Professional Firefighters. Whereas Mrs. Fannie Elizabeth Cotton Cockfield
worked at the Federal Building downtown for 30 years. She also was a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Incorporated and a proud graduate of Southern University. Ms. Cockfield was the mother-in-law of Assistant Chief Edward Whatley Sr., grandmother of both Brother Edward Whatley Jr. and Brother David Whatley. She was also the great-grandmother of Brother Askia Shahid. All four are longtime members of the Vanguards of Cleveland and the International Association of Black Professional Firefighters. Our next resolution is coming from Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated. Whereas soror Fannie Cockfield joined the Sisterhood of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority 77 years ago on the Southern University campus of Baton Rouge. Amen. Whereas soror Fannie Cockfield served dutifully in Alpha Omega Chapter and obtained diamond status after 75 years. Praise God. Be it still further resolved that a copy of this resolution will be presented to the family of soror Fannie Cockfield. Our next one is coming from the National Active and Retired Federal Employees Association. The officers and members of the Association of Active and Retired Federal Employees. Fannie was a past president and faithful member for years. In his own way and for his own purpose, God has reached down into his garden and plucked one of his. Humbly submitted the NARFE chapter 2232, Cleveland East, Dolores Gaines, president. Our next resolution is coming from the United Black Christians, United Church of Christ. Whereas her life was one that affirmed and supported the pursuit of justice and peace, and whereas her life was consistent testimony to the gentle kindness of God's abundant grace, and whereas her positive attitude and beautiful smile was a reminder of the joy of discipleship. Fannie Cockfield, a faithful supporter and member. Submitted Cloggy Crowder, president, and Ciola Littlejohn, secretary. This resolution is coming from the People's Community Baptist Church, where Haywood Robinson III is the senior pastor. Whereas Fannie Cockfield departed from this earth for another land, a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God, Hebrews 11 and 10. Be it resolved that the 11th day of December 23rd, that we express to Darlene Cockfield and the family and friends who grieve our deepest sympathy in their loss, and remind them that the loss is Fannie's gain. We commend you and your family to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are satisfied. That is Acts 20 and 32. And will the members of South Euclid United Church of Christ stand, please? To the family of our beloved Fannie Cotton Cockfield, we, the members of South Euclid United Church of Christ, want the family to know that our hearts are with you as you gather to bid a Christian goodbye and to a valiant woman of God. Fannie was a faithful member of South Euclid United Church of Christ who loved the Lord and his church. Whereas Fannie actively served in our congregation and our church through the Ben Ministry. Whereas the Apostle Paul reminds us that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, and that a crown of righteousness awaits those who have fought the good fight, kept the faith, and finished their course. Therefore, be it resolved that we extend our deepest sympathy to the bereaved family and family and friends in this sad hour. Humbly submitted, Reverend Courtney Clayton Jenkins, our pastor and teacher. Now, in your program, there is a litany of consolation. I will start, and then the congregation will go to the next line. Oh God, as we weep with tearful eyes and bereaved spirits, we do not weep as those who have no hope, but in faith, hope, and love. Lord, give us strength to understand our yesterdays, face today's, and embrace our tomorrows. O God, we thank thee that death is not a period, but a comma, not in the end of the paragraph of life. You, O Lord, are the Alpha and Omega. Death is but a jot and a tittle in the journey of life. And they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. The dangers of life are not in dying, but in living without faith, hope, love, dreams, and aspirations. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. In unison, Lord, thou hast made us for thyself, and our hearts are forever restless till we rest in thee. Amen.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her whine. She felt such pain. Some spoke with anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came through the shame that flushed her face. Still at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. I've come to pour my praise on you like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Don't be angry when I wash his feet with my tears and dry them with my hair. You weren't there the night he found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his love. way life used to be. I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. I spent my day pouring my life without measure into a little treasure box. I thought I'd found, until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonders of His touch. So now I am giving back to Him all the praise He's worthy of. I am forgiven, and that's why
Amen, amen. We are thankful for the life and legacy of Fannie Cockfield. We're thankful for the words of reflection offered by her family. We're thankful for the gifts that have been utilized today to honor her and to celebrate the God that she loved and a life well lived. Amen. Amen, amen. Just want to share a few brief words with you in reflection on the life of Miss Fannie Cockfield. I want to read to you from Psalm 91, beginning at verse 14. I want to read it first in the NIV translation, and then I'd like to read it a second time in the Message, because I think Fannie would have had a little chuckle at the Message translation. So Psalm 91, beginning at verse 14, the NIV, these words are found there. Because she loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue her. I will protect her, for she acknowledges my name. She will call on me and I will answer her. I will be with her in trouble. I will deliver her and honor her. And after 96 years, with long life, I will satisfy her and show her my salvation. Psalm 91 in the Message translation reads this way. If you hold on to me for dear life, says the Lord, I'll get you out of any trouble. I'll give you the best of care if you'll only get to know and trust me. Call me and I'll answer. Be at your side in bad times. I'll rescue you. This is the part for Fannie. Then throw you a party. I'll give you a long life and give you a long drink of salvation. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, hearing, teaching, and preaching of God's most holy and gracious word. Would you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable, O Lord, You are my strength and my redeemer. Step in now, O God, use me, for I am thine. Let us, O God, provide this capstone moment for this family to remember their beloved and to encourage them to live out the legacy she provided as an ongoing love letter to you and as thanks to her. In Jesus' name we pray and ask it all. Amen. 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 96 years. 96 years. Led through moments that many did not survive. 96 years. Born in 1927, 96 years later, this woman said goodbye. Over those 96 years, she survived the Great Depression, a time of economic challenge and poverty, but somehow God saw her through. Survived and witnessed World War II, running from 1939 to 1945. Witnessed and saw on televisions for the first time the civil rights movement, saw them marching and boycotting. She lived to see and lived to tell. But as if civil rights wasn't enough, she lived on through women's rights. A woman who came to our church and embedded herself in the Women's Association because she believed in the commonality of what women brought to the table, lived through the Vietnam War, lived through the assassination of King, lived to watch man land on the moon in 1969, witnessed the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Cold War, lived to tell about the attacks on September 11th, 2001, lived to see the election of the first black president of the United States of America in Barack Obama, and lived through a pandemic where so many young and old lost their lives. And Miss Fannie Cockfield took a licking, but she kept on ticking. We thank God for what she witnessed. We thank God for what she survived. We thank God for the lessons that she learned but didn't harbor to herself, but shared them with her children and her grandchildren and her neighbors, because there are others who have lived through these moments, but they have shut them down. But Miss Fannie Cockfield didn't just survive the moments, she thrived through the moments and provided us with the evidence of how a queen lives through challenging times with grace, with grit, with gratitude, and with guidance. Psalm 91 is the psalm of protection. And if you ask me, an African-American woman coming to us from the southern state of Louisiana, migrating north, is indeed the story of a woman who was protected in her journey. I know we are born here in Cleveland. We are up north. Some would say we are northern Negroes. But the truth of the matter is that to be reared in the South in the late 1920s, and to see poverty like people had not seen it before, didn't matter whether it was born into her home or not, she could not escape the stories of how others were surviving in that time. And then to push to Southern University, a time when still it was rare for women to go to college. Rare for men to go to college, but exceptionally rare for women to go to college and to have an education. And I was baffled as a physical education teacher. Fannie liked to kick around and kick up. But I thought about how the hand of God had to be on this woman to come from the South to the North, to come from college to finding a job, to meeting her husband. And I know anyone who's been married would agree that through all of those years of marriage, those 48 years, God's hand of protection was on her life. The words of verse 14, open up because she loves me, said the Lord. I will rescue her. I will protect her. She acknowledges my name. You see, if you read through her obituary, they provided only a small amount of the words of wisdom and encourage. These Fannie Cockfield sayings, is it kind and is it necessary? She shared these words of wisdom because she knew what it meant for God to be your rescuer, God to be your protector, for God to be the person that when you called on God, God would come. And many times why she offered these words of wisdom was because she didn't want you to block your blessing. What does it mean to be a guard of the protection of blessings of future generations? To teach people, we need it in this day and age, to watch what you say. But thank God Fannie wasn't just a woman who talked the talk. She was a woman who walked the walk. Watch what you say. Watch what you do. Don't block your blessings, because God is a protector that you can call on God and God will come and see about you. God said, I know this woman of faith. God says, I'm so thankful that today, I want you to hear this, we haven't gathered out of routine, but we have gathered out of relationship. See, people pass away all the time, but sometimes we gather for final services out of routine because this is what you're supposed to do. But then there are people like Fannie Cockfield who know God. We are not here out of routine or out of ritual. We are here because this woman could testify and share that God was the one who rescued her. God was the one who saved her, that she called upon God's name. And God said, oh, I know Fannie's voice when she calls on me. I visited with Miss Cockfield just a few weeks ago, just prior to Thanksgiving. I wasn't quite sure what I was going to walk into. But typical to Fannie Cockfield, she had words for me. Amen. I didn't even know. She put her finger up. I leaned in. But I'm thankful that this woman knew God, knew God's protection, knew God's care. Goes on in verse 15. It says it in the Message translation of the 15th verse. It says, and I found this so interesting, it says, I'll give you the best of care if you'll only get to know and trust me. I mentioned to you that I visited with Miss Cockfield a couple weeks ago. And I saw something, Ross, that I rarely see these days. A woman kept in her son's home to be cared for by his son and his daughter, and for her to have round-the-clock care. I think we were there, you said, you ready for some snack, some treat? That's why she was spoiled. But I say this and I read this verse that God says, I'll give you the best care. When we come towards the end of life, people are forced to make all different types of decisions, and many which are uncomfortable to us. But I think we honored her southern roots by bringing her home, bringing her into the safety of that front room, which was had dolls placed all around it, a large TV for her to watch her programs. It's a different generation. They watch programs. But as we stepped in that room and had prayer as a family, my spirit was pricked because, and no judgment to anyone else, we're talking about you and your family. People don't take care of their loved ones like you all took care of your mother. And I think that these are the moments that when people are thinking about the end of life, they're often thinking about the very end. But God says to those who call upon me, to those who know me, to those who have found a life and a love in my bosom, I'm gonna put you down in the warmth of a home. For your final years to have home cooked meals, in your final years to have nursing attendants. We read the list of women who came over the years to care and to help care. And I need to say to both of you that this is a testimony, Ross and Susan, of not only God's grace on your life, but my prayer is that the same love and care and comfort that you provided for your mother, you will see the rewards of it yourself. People don't take care of their mothers like you all took care of your mother. It didn't have to be perfect, but it came from a well deeply, deeply anchored in love. And when I read that verse in the message, I could not move forward because I hear Fannie, and I always do this when I do funerals. I ask the deceased, what do you want to say? And she said, tell them, thank you. Thank you. You didn't have to care for me like that. Thank you. Verse 16 goes on then to say that you'll call me and I'll answer you. Be at your bedside in bad times, I'll rescue you and throw you a party. She said, talk about the party. She said, a party for me? Yes, a party for you. You know, I came to know Miss Fannie Cockfield more intimately when we used to have back in our old Euclid Avenue days a special day where we would decorate the church for the holiday season. And she would come in. She was on her cane at that point, but she was carrying the cane. The cane wasn't really carrying her, if you know what I mean. She just kind of held it up in the air. So you got to put that down. Supposed to anchor you. I'm all right. She, come on in. But I met her there where she took pride in her crafts, where she took pride in being in the fellowship of the saints and of the body of Christ. And I have to say that when we moved to this building, we have this special parking on the left for our seasoned saints. And that black Ford Focus, I know my people, that black Ford Focus would scoop up Cloggy Crowder, and they told me they had to get here in time to get the spots designated for the seasoned saints. When she walked in, she said, I don't know about this carpet, but I definitely like those parking spots out there for the seasoned saints. She says, now we can park close and we can get on in. And I need to say that the piece that Rhonda shared about Fannie and Cloggy, about Cloggy and Fannie, that when the doors of the church opened, these two women would drive a little fast,
up in that Ford Focus, into the spot, park, come on in, Cloggy would head towards the children, and Fannie would come right in over here in this back section and find her seat and make her way. A party. You know, parties happen in all different kinds of ways. There are big parties, and often at the big parties, there's lots of people there, people we know and people we don't know, people we love and people we'd prefer not to see. And then there are these small, intimate parties, these dinner parties, if you will. These moments of sitting around the table with those we love and we care about and breaking bread with them so that we might have a moment of fellowship. I find it quite ironic that Miss Fannie lived just to the other side of Thanksgiving, a time where family gathers to say thank you. A time where family comes together to give thanks to God and thanks to one another. And I came to tell you that Fannie said, today I'm at a great party. A party where I can sit down with my Savior and with my Lord. A party where I am reunited with my daughter Kay, a party where I am reunited with my husband. And though I have had a time of my life for 96 years partying with you all, today I sit down in a house not made with hands, also with loved ones for whom I have been holding up the matriarch moment of this family. But today she has passed the baton to you all to sit down with those she has loved and those she has missed. And now her role, I want you to hear this. She's still there. It's just different now. Rather than looking at you, she spends her days watching over you. I want you to hear this. The wisdom is still there. The grace and the grit and the gratitude is still there. She said, but I spent 96 years sowing it into the earth so that I could take my rest at this party and you all could live on and live out. These words that she knows fell on good soil. So today, we offer you peace because she's at peace. We offer you hope because she had a hope that never disappointed her. We offer you a legacy because she knows hers has not ended. It now lives on in each of you. Amen, amen, and amen. Amen. We thank God for this reminder of who Fannie was and the reminder of who her Savior was. We are going to invite the staff of E.F. Boyd and Son to come forward. Our interment will be, I believe, at Lakeview Cemetery, correct? We're asking you if you intend to travel with us to the cemetery where we will offer our final interment, that you would put your flashers on and indicate to the staff that you might receive a flag. We ask any women who might be willing to serve as flower bearers if you would come forward at this time. We need women who would come forward and assist with carrying of flowers. I'm thinking we need at least 11 women. Thank you so much for serving. And you could take those straight to the center doors, down the stairs that lead to the outside. Thank you so much. Please be careful. Very good. I think we have enough, just about one more here. Great, or two. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
If the pallbearers would please stand and come forward and line up two by two here. I want to make sure we have six gentlemen. I think we do. Then if the family would please rise. Psalm 46 declares, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged, the kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice and the earth melted.
Oh, well, thank you.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolation in the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow, cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots in fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. The days of our lives are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80 years, yet their boast is only labor and sorrow, for soon it is cut off and we fly away. Amen. This concludes the services for Fannie Cockfield. We will resume at Lakeview Cemetery. Again, please place your flashers as we proceed. Amen.